afternoon, everyone. I'm Greg Gumbel. Welcome to CBS Sports Road to the Final Four. Let the madness begin. And I haven't said that since a chemistry final back in school. Today, we begin our exclusive live coverage of the NCAA tournament. 64 teams will play 63 games with one dream: to be the last team standing at the Alamo Dome in San Antonio. Joining me in our mecca of March Madness are Clark Double-Double Kellogg, who averaged 12.3 points and 10.3 rebounds in three NCAA tournament games, and the legendary coach Dean Smith, one of only two men to win a national championship as a player and a coach. And this is the first time that you haven't been head coaching a team in a tournament in about, what, 31 years? What are they going through right now?
Everyone should be very nervous. I know I like it better here. I really do think it's the most exciting time of all college basketball right today.
It is strange to see him sitting here instead of out there,
isn't it? Let's throw it up. Let's play. Let's get this festival of hoops going. I'm looking across the board, and one of the things that jumps out at me is the balance of the field and strong perimeter play. I'm very much looking forward to Dial and Boykins against Michigan State's Mateen Cleaves and Charles Bell tonight in a matchup within that matchup.
All right, gentlemen, we begin our tip to trophy coverage with action from the East region. In Hartford, Navy takes aim at the number one team in the land, North Carolina, tipping off at 12:20. The Patriot League tournament champion Midshipmen hope to become the first 16 seed to submarine a number one seed behind senior forward Hassan Booker, who earned the conference rebounding crown. But North Carolina's powerful ship is steered by Antoine Jameson, the player considered by many the best in the land. Jameson is the first Tar Heel in 30 years named ACC Player of the Year and Conference Tournament MVP in the same season. At 12:25, we'll tip off another East matchup, this one in our nation's capital. 11th-seeded Washington, as in the state, meets 6th-seed Xavier. Junior guard Donald Watts has electrified Huskies fans this season. 12 20-point games to lead Washington to its first tournament appearance in a dozen years. Meanwhile, the Musketeers have dropped the sword on 7 of their last 8 foes, and will be counting on junior guard Lenny Brown, who averaged 15 points a game as Xavier captured the Atlantic 10 tournament. And then, for some of you, at 12:40, we'll go west to Boise, Idaho, for a meeting of former Atlantic 10 rivals, 10th-seeded West Virginia battles 7th-seed Temple. Coming up in our second set of games, tipping off at about 2:40 Eastern time, most of you will see a West Region meeting between 13th-seed Utah State and number 4-seed Maryland, which took North Carolina to overtime in the ACC tournament semifinals. Let's talk about the keys to this day. What are they?
Well, I think balance, and again, we talk about perimeter play and guard play specifically. That's always a key factor in tournaments. But more than that, I think imposing your will, whatever your team does, imposing that will on the opposition.
Well, and remember, a 14-seed playing a 3-seed sounds like it should be a blowout. It won't be. There are too many close games today, and I really think that Richmond-South Carolina game will be exciting.
All right, Coach, coming up, we'll see if Arizona has what it takes to bring home the crown again when the road to the Final Four continues after this. Primetime game this evening, tipping off about 10 o'clock Eastern time. Nicholls State meets its match and then some in defending national champion Arizona, a team looking to relive last year's sweet success.
The milestone victory for Arizona. Simon Says championship.
Now, the Wildcats want to say repeat, just like Duke did in 1991 and 92.
I think we're probably 30% better, like Coach Olsen was saying. I think we're a lot more mature, we're a lot more experienced. We know it takes to win a championship.
We don't think that anybody can stop us, how we're playing right now, and I mean, our confidence level's at a high right now, so we think we're unstoppable.
Now, the thing we have to do is just buckle down and concentrate and just come out and play hard every game. We're picked to be in San Antonio, therefore that gives us a lot of pressure, but I think we're a team that we work well under pressure.
Arizona is the 8th defending champ to return all 5 starters of the next season, but only one of those squads, John Wooden's UCLA team of exactly 30 years ago, was able to repeat. They're more experienced, they're more confident. The question is, can they do it again?
Saran wrap D, spurred ability, the confidence of a champion, their favorites to win it again.
You sure?
I'm positive.
All right, the road to the Final Four continues after this word from your local station.
puts it up. Simon says championship.
The watchword of the month, holy mackerel. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Greg Gumbel. Welcome to CBS Sports' exclusive tip-to-trophy coverage of the NCAA tournament. Today, we begin the journey down that winding road to the Final Four, which ends up in San Antonio with the national championship. Helping sort it all out are Clark Kellogg, who appeared in a pair of NCAA tournaments with Ohio State, and Dean Smith, who coached a pair of NCAA champions at North Carolina. You know, I can tell these are excitable times because we need to find you a seatbelt. You can't sit still.
You know what it reminds me of? 64 companies all going public at the same time with varied histories, different earnings momentum, but the only team that can have the claim on best return on assets is the one at the end of 3 weeks that can say they're the champion.
What a business mind.
Yeah, he majored in business, but you know, the higher seed is supposed to wear the light jerseys, and they aren't all going to win today.
All right, Coach and Clark, we begin the day with the Beast of the East, the nation's top team, the North Carolina Tar Heels, tip off at 12:20 against Patriot League power Navy. Others will see the East clash between 6th seed Xavier, the Atlantic 10 tournament champ, and the 11th seeded Washington Huskies. And some of you will see the West region tip off at 12:40 as 7th seed Temple faces 10th seed West Virginia. Then our 2:40 Eastern block of games is headlined by the 4th seed in the West, Maryland, taking on Utah State. Coming up, we'll hear from North Carolina coach Bill Guthridge before his first NCAA tournament game as a head coach when the road to the Final Four continues after this. Some of you will head to Hartford as Navy meets East top seed North Carolina. A short time ago, Armin Katayan spoke with Tar Heels' first-year head coach, Bill Guthridge.
Hey, Bill. How you doing? Morning. Well, you've made this trip hundreds of times before as an assistant coach to the tournament. What were your thoughts today as you came in as a head coach for the first time?
Really no different. Until somebody brings it up to me, I don't think of it differently. But when I thought of it differently, it was the first exhibition game, first practice, first real game. But now I've been doing it a year, so I still think of it the same way.
Any theme for this team in this tournament as you start today against Navy?
Well, we have to play hard every time out. You can't take anything for granted, and I don't think our team will. They've been real great about each practice and each game, so we hope we'll be ready.
Good luck, Bill.
Thanks.
Coach Guthridge says he brings the same mindset as a head coach as he did as an assistant. Can you do that?
Well, he's really involved all the time. For 30 years as an assistant, he's been offered head jobs, and everybody's back there except Serge Wicker last year and Dean Smith. So same group, they ought to feel very confident.
They are a confident team because they have talent, they've got experience, and I think Coach Guthridge has tremendous confidence in his unit, and those players have great confidence in him. It's a hand-in-glove fit.
All right, guys, coming up, some of you will see Washington and Xavier from the nation's capital. Everyone else will begin in Hartford as Navy battles North Carolina. Those of you expecting to see West Virginia against Temple in the West, we will send you out to Boise in time for your tip at 12:40. We're on our way to the Final Four, everyone. Enjoy the ride and enjoy the games here on CBS.
CBS Sports' exclusive coverage of the NCAA Basketball Championship is sponsored by Genuine Chevrolet, Bud Light, Visa, and by Enterprise Rent-A-Car.
CBS Sports welcomes you to the nation's capital. It's the first and second rounds of the East Sub-Regional. And our first game, the 16th-seeded Navy midshipman against the number... against Richmond. Tonight, Indiana takes on Oklahoma, and the number 2 seed Connecticut takes on Fairleigh Dickinson University. Hello, everyone, and welcome. I'm Sean McDonough along with Bill Raffi, and it's great to have you with us. Time is up if you have not yet filled in your brackets. And Bill, as folks around the country have gone about that task, a popular middle seed given a chance to do a lot of damage in this tournament, as the team we'll see in the first game today, the Xavier Musketeers.
Everyone's looking for a team that's getting hot. Well, they got hot in their tournament, played terrific basketball, very disruptive team, good speed, and they can finish.
For many years, their backcourt, the last couple of years at least, was considered one of the most underrated in the country, but now the duo of Lenny Brown and Gary Lumpkin is considered one of the best backcourt tandems.
Well, this is a disruptive pair. This is a team that likes to push the basketball. This is going to be a tempo game. If Xavier has its way, it'll be played between the top of the key and the top of the key. But they also have a guy that everybody in the country is going to enjoy watching play, James Posey. Best six man the last 2 years, the United had the ability to shoot outside, to run the floor, and he can finish with the best of them, Sean.
And apparently the Washington Huskies, one of the last teams to get into the field of 64 as an at-large team. They are a number 11 seed with a record of 18-9. Folks around the country don't know much about Todd McCullough, but on the West Coast, they know about the seven-footer.
Well, you've been considered a soft touch yourself. Well, this big guy...
All right, Armin, and the starting lineup. We start with the midshipmen, Hassan Booker, Matt Slatke, Josh Williams. In the front court with Michael Heary and Skip Victor. A dynamic backcourt in the backcourt. Meanwhile, for the Tar Heels, Antoine Jameson, Adimola Okalaja, Maktar Jai in the front court with Vince Carter and Shamond Williams in the backcourt. And the head coach for the North Carolina Tar Heels, 30 years as an assistant under Dean Smith, his first year as the head coach, Bill Guthridge. He's the ACC Coach of the Year, and today he was named the Sporting News Coach of the Year. And the officials, Tom Harrington, George Evans, and Eric Harmon. So North Carolina, 30-3 on the season, 13-3 in the ACC. They won the tournament, beating Duke against Navy, 19-10 on the season, and we are underway the NCAA tournament. The East, North Carolina, the number one seed against Navy, seeded number 16. And a turnover on the first possession for the Tar Heels.
And Don DeVoe's ball club will play man-to-man defense. Historically, his teams always have. We will see at some point this afternoon if he tries a little bit of zone.
Michael Heary draws Shamond Williams. Heary, fourth all-time leading scorer at Navy. Josh Williams and Hassan Booker guarded by Antoine Jameson.
Carolina man-to-man defense. Navy has to handle the basketball each possession and find open shots, and right away, off to a good start by Slatke.
Matt Slatke, a junior from Wadsworth, Ohio, nails the three-pointer, and the midshipmen take an early lead. Vince Carter to the basket, and he swoops in and lays it off the glass.
Big, strong bodies. North Carolina has a lot of them. Carter, one of the finest in the country at going to the hole.
Vince Carter, first team All-ACC. Williams drops up on the baseline, forced it up, and it's ripped down by Antoine Jameson.
Don DeVoe said yesterday, Gus, we just have to play as hard as we can and play our game. We can't do too many things that we haven't done all season long.
Knocked away. Second turnover. Here's Booker inside. Great look, Slatke. Had it rejected, though, by Jameson. Williams in transition. Pull up three-pointer. Got it.
His shooting may be the key for this ball club to win a national championship. He brings everybody out. When he gets on a roll, he's one of the best players in the country shooting the basketball.
They call it a two. It's foot on the line. Inside Williams again. And it's contested by Maktar Jai. Shamond Williams, second team All-ACC with the basketball. And an offensive foul called against the Tar Heels.
Gus, not the pace of game that the Naval Academy want right now. Up and down will favor this Carolina Blue.
And I asked Don DeVoe yesterday, what's the strategy taking on the number one team in the country? He said, well, we're going to get up early, and we're not going to give them back the lead. So it's pretty simple.
And we talked about it. He started mentioning, you know, it was fun in the old days when you didn't have that shot clock. You could get up about 2 or 3 to nothing and then pull the ball out to half court, run a lot of four corners.
Antoine Jameson called for the foul. Carolina in the zone.
Patience on offense, a lot of body movement, ball movement. When the shot clock gets down to around 10, then start finding some opening.
Six on the shot clock, Hassan Booker. Inside, Williams. Reverse layup, won't go. Tipped up and in, though.
by Skip Victor, the junior from Cerritos, California.
Well, Victor coming off the MVP of the Patriot Tournament, where he was outstanding. Last four ball games averaged over 16 points. He had 18 in the championship game against Lafayette.
Was a great football player, wide receiver coming out of high school, wanted to play basketball, however. Jump hook inside, Maktar Jai. The senior from Dakar, Senegal. Played his first couple of years at the University of Michigan with Jawan Howard. Carolina going up 6-5, 17-10 to go in the first half of play from Hartford. Number one versus number 16, Carolina and Navy. Slatke around the screen to the basket, pull up jump shot. And it's tapped out, recovered by Williams. Carter got the step on the baseline, cut off nicely though by Slatke.
And Navy playing man-to-man defense, but they are sagging inside. They're not guarding Okalaja, they're not guarding Jai outside, they're daring them to shoot the basketball.
Third turnover for North Carolina, and coming into this game, many of the assistants for Navy wanted Don DeVoe to play a 2-3 zone. However, he's a man-to-man coach, and it seems as if, Don, he's kind of made some changes there, sagging down on that North Carolina offense.
Well, what a lot of coaches do that run man-to-man strictly will do some soft man-to-man and play back off. A bomb that time by Michael Heary, and that's a good start for that man.
Robbed inside, rebounded by Williams. Now, don't forget, some of you will see West Virginia and Temple coming up in a few minutes. 12:40 tip-off time.
See if Damian Owens and Adrian Pledger can solve that Temple zone defense.
Those two teams very familiar with each other. West Virginia playing in the Big East now, but prior to that, they played for years in the Atlantic 10. Neil Catlett and John Chaney very familiar with their system.
And they're going to sag off Ed Cota also and dare him to make shots. So very soft man-to-man. They're going to stay on Carter. They're going to stay on Jamison.
Here's Slatke again at it, blocked by Njai, out of bounds. We stay right here. Timeout on the floor, 15:43 to go in the first half of play. Navy leading it by two.
Teray Braggs for Xavier. And the tournament is underway here in Washington, D.C. as Xavier controlled the tip.
And the Huskies go man-to-man, Sean McDonough.
First time these two have ever met on the basketball court. And a quick shot, hoisted for two by Lenny Brown, the junior from Wilmington, Delaware.
And Sean, that gets their press set. Very tough denial. The face guard out the floor. Perfect trap situation. They'll take advantage. Uptick, and they go back to minimum as well. And that's a key. Luton can make jumper, Sean.
Deion Luton, a streaky shooter, but he's been hot lately.
What they tell us yesterday, if he makes his first few, he can be a tough out.
He has almost half of the three-pointers made by Washington this year. Now 67 of the 136 the Huskies have as a team. Williams the miss. And the putback is short from Johnson, but run down by Braggs. Williams all alone. Estelo Green hit the deck and came up grasping at his mouth, and he's still a little bit woozy as he heads back up court.
I tell you, he is groggy. He took some banging. McCullough got pushed. He's going to have to hold his ground. Very aggressive rebounding team, the Musketeers.
Wooten kicked it ahead to Donald Watts, and he was stripped by Torrey Braggs.
Compliment the pressure defense with the early push.
Lumpkin, tough shot, the tip in by Bragg, spun out, and a foul on the rebound action. It's against Braggs over the back of McCullough. That's the first foul in the game.
The ability to knock shots down, so important. You can just see the great look, the outside jumper, and then the inside game, and nobody at home as Green was counting the chiplets a little bit. Bender had said that they're used to full court pressure playing against Arizona and UCLA and even Arizona State, so they feel they've seen the Xavier pressure before.
three games to go in the regular season, and the Huskies won all three to secure the bid. They were definitely in trouble in terms of not making the tournament before they won their last three. Deion Luton gets the bounce. He is all 5 Washington points, and the Huskies lead by 1.
That's important for Xavier not to let McCullough get touches. The big guy's got a very deft touch.
Lumpkin shut off by Wooten. Now Brown guarded by Luton.
The guards can shoot and break you down with the dribble. It's a tough thing to defend.
Brown with the blow by, and he made the layup.
The blow by to the chin shot. That is pretty. Well, if your execution is imperfect, give it to the talented guard.
Watts fouled in the backcourt by Brown. First foul on Lenny.
Well, the lingering lingerie early here in disarray. The ability to set his man up between the legs. You had that move in your younger days.
Yes, still do.
And then avoid the 7-footer with the left. And that's a total game.
Xavier by 1, nearly 3 minutes play.
Restrict McCullough. That's what they're trying to do. Nice help defensively.
Green got shut off by T.J. Johnson. Now Braggs leading the break. Wisely gave it up to Lumpkin, and he was fouled by Wooten.
Getting back and then identifying, you can't turn it over in vulnerable areas. A nice hedge defensively. I mean, that sets up the offense for good teams. I mean, they just churn it up on the defensive end, force you to cough it up and go the other way.
So now Lumpkin shoots a pair, the junior from Newcastle, Delaware. I mentioned he and Brown have been backcourt mates since they were in the 8th grade. They did high school together at William Penn. And now at Xavier. Certainly dramatically different backgrounds. Lumpkin grew up the son of a minister. His dad died when he was 6 years old, but Gary stayed very active in the church, played the organ with the church choir. Praised before every game. Well, Lenny Brown had a very tough background, grew up about 5 miles away, but in a much rougher neighborhood. He sold drugs when he was 15 years old. Says if it wasn't for basketball, he'd probably be dead or in jail. But basketball has helped get his life on track, and he's left that tough pass behind.
Well, you say prayers before every game, and you can tell you're working with me. But the counter there, the push, McCullough getting himself in position. They aren't answered very often either, I might add.
As a matter of fact, they went over 4 games with you today.
Skip Prosser, that shot, a little annoyed at his team not getting back. How about his run? 11 of 13 years, Skip has been in the NCAA, both as an assistant to Pete Gillen and then at Loyola. And, of course, he has taken a lot of Pete Gillen's philosophy and expanded it into his own. Very professorial type of coach.
For history teacher in high school in West Virginia before making the move to college coaching. Todd McCullough with the missed free throws and then a foul on the follow-up action on Thalo Green. First on Green, a redshirt freshman from Salem, Oregon, who is still running his tongue over his lips and teeth. He took a shot in the face early and is still obviously battling the after effects.
Well, they say he plays old, you know, funny little running hooks and all. Time physical play, nice post pass to Braggs. Lumpkin on the money.
And Braggs the finish for his first bucket. Braggs is a senior from Fresno, California. Came to X from San Jose City College.
This could help Watts eventually. He's got to drive to the goal line. The press, if he can get over the top and attack, he's terrific with the bounce.
Xavier's run off 6 straight points. Take a 5-point lead and a bump in a low post on McCullough. And that's his first, and they can't afford to see him get into foul trouble.
And Sean, the more you watch Xavier in tape, they're a great post-passing team, but they're unselfish. They'll put spin on the ball to make it come back to the offensive postman.
Brown, that's a 2-pointer. And the rebound by McCullough. A junior from Winnipeg, Manitoba, played hockey, as you might expect, growing up in Canada as a young boy. Said he played hockey until he was about 13, but that's when they started allowing checking in his youth hockey league, and he said that rough stuff wasn't for me.
And, of course, he's getting a little rough stuff down in the box right now. Of course, he must have had some shots taken at him in hockey.
He was always taller than his contemporaries. Shot clock now at 8.
And they finally get it to him. Look at the job Johnson's been doing. No clean catches for the big guy.
3 turnovers by Washington already, and then Bragg turned it back over with a travel. Nearly 4.5 minutes played in Washington, D.C., and Xavier has a 5-point lead.
Remember when Virginia lost to Chaminade in Hawaii, I believe it was 82, Jameson inside fouled by Josh Williams, and they feel that they can be a team that can pull off which would be the biggest upset in college basketball history.
And why not? You know, you slow down the pace, you play defense in a way to make someone else beat you. Don DeVoe has been through all the wars, been different teams. Virginia Tech was outstanding. Tennessee had some great ball clubs, a quick stop at Florida, and has found a home right here for the Naval Academy.
So Antoine Jameson, 6'9", 223-pound junior from Charlotte at the free throw line, and the first one rattling out. He's a 68% shooter on the season. He was fouled by Josh Williams. And a lot of people are asking Antoine, are you going to leave college early? But according to him, he really likes Tim Duncan and Keith Van Horn, how they stayed in college for 4 years. He models himself after those two guys.
Well, let's hope he stays.
Don't forget West Virginia Temple. Some of you will be going out west to see that game shortly. And a corner jump shot, Asan Booker nails it, and North Carolina allows Navy to tie it up at 14 apiece.
You know, Gus, you mentioned that Temple, West Virginia, and a great matchup, but there are two teams that teams hate to prepare for, and that's Princeton and Temple, because you don't have enough time to play against their style and have a couple days of practice. So Gale Catlett used to many things, but the players will be a little bit surprised how aggressive John Chaney's zone defense is.
A matchup zone always nasty against opponents, especially in March. Max Dargi at the line.
You know, Gus, I would expect Carolina to pick the pace up a little bit defensively. Put some more pressure on the ball, whether it's full court or even in the half court set. Get after the dribble a little more. Increase the tempo, allow them to run, get some breaks, get some steals. If they continue to set back and let Navy run their half court offense, it's going to be a slowdown game. It's going to be in the 50s, and that's a tough ball game to win sometimes.
Adimola Okalaja checking back into the game. Jai, second free throw is good. 16-14, 13:04 to go in the first half. North Carolina leads Navy. Here's Booker, pull-up jump shot. Rebounded, Victor, and it's blocked, and Jai with the recovery. Go to the other way. Vince Carter wide open for 3, and he got it. So Vince Carter, who according to his coaches has taken a lot more pride in his defense instead of his offense, with the offense clicking in right there for him.
He still has a little firepower on that offensive end.
No doubt about it. And another turnover for the midshipman on the baseline, number 4. Now out west, here's the bracket. Arkansas, Nebraska, Utah, San Francisco, Temple, West Virginia, and Cincinnati, winners of Conference USA, against Northern Arizona. Jameson jump hook on the baseline, and he got it. 12:21 to go. Carolina leading at 21-14.
So the top seed in the East, the Tar Heels, with a 21-14 lead on Navy. We will keep you advised as to the progress of that game. But for those of you looking to Boise, Idaho, we're going to send you out to the 12:40 Eastern tip between West Virginia and Temple. The Mountaineers, the number 10 seed. The Temple Owls, number 7. Former Atlantic 10 rivals. Let's join Jim Durham and Greg Kelsey.
Welcome to Boise, where we fire up this West region with 7th-seeded Temple taking on 10th-seeded West Virginia in game 1 of a 4-game day here at Boise State University at the Pavilion. The winner of this one gets the winner of Cincinnati, Northern Arizona, then the night games, as you can see. Good morning, everyone. Jim Durham with Greg Kellogg, and we welcome you to today's first game. Two teams that like to think they play some pretty good defense. One thing's for sure, West Virginia has an outstanding defender in Damian Owens.
You know, Damian Owens is a terrific basketball player. He does everything for West Virginia. He scores, he passes, Chip, because when you're going against Temple and their vaunted matchup zone defense, you have to have poise and patience.
And Temple has a good defender in that matchup zone in Pepe Sanchez.
Well, if you know anything about Temple, they like to keep you off balance offensively. They press all over the place. And Sanchez is one of the country's best defensive players. He really keys their effort in terms of creating that pressure and that havoc.
These teams this time of year like to think they've got some depth. Temple does. And with more on that, we go to our sideline reporter, Mike Mayock.
Thanks, Jimmy. You know, and John Chaney, 16 years at Temple, he's always believed that first-year players should not be seen or heard. But the athletic ability and maturity of Quincy Watley and Lynn Greer has changed all that. Watley comes off the bench, averages 25 minutes a game, brings a tremendous defensive intensity. Greer is a silky left-hander, shoots over 48% from beyond the arc. Now they both shoot over 80% from the foul line, so look for them in crunch time. In John Chaney's own words, they bring us to a different level. Jim?
Gale Catlett, his 20th season at West Virginia, winning percentage of 643, and he sends the Mountaineers out like this. What would a West Virginia team be in the NCAA tournament without a West in the backcourt? And Jared West starts at one guard spot. Brent Lewin anchors the middle, and Brent Soldheim plays with Damian Owens up front. As for John Chaney and the Temple Owls, 16 years at Temple, a 71% winning percentage. And the Owls start the game with Dunkley, Stewart, and Barnes up front, Sanchez and Brokenborough in the backcourt. These two teams, of course, up until 3 years ago, played together in the Atlantic 10 Conference, so they've played a lot. Temple leads the overall series 36-33. Larry Rose, Don McAllister, and Mike Thibodeau are the officials today. We're getting ready to go from Boise State with our first game of this morning and afternoon session, and West Virginia controlling the opening tip. West and Fletcher are the guards. West is 23. West Virginia in the dark uniforms. Temple, the higher seed with the seventh seed in their home white uniforms.
Right away, Temple comes out in that man-to-man defense. You notice the patience being used right now by West Virginia. Shot clock under 10.
In fact, it's at 4. And West, 4-3. Temple with the rebound.
At some point, West Virginia is going to try to slash players into the middle to try and hit the seams of the zone defense. Again, you have to move the ball. You have to move your people and be very patient. Man-to-man defense for West Virginia.
This is Sanchez, 4. Working a play to the inside, and Owens comes out with a steal. He specializes in that. Pledger missing off the layup attempt, and Soldheim there to clean up for the Mountaineers.
There's a running opportunity for West Virginia. They, too, will try to get the steals and go in transition. They're not going to want to set up and work for every single basket. If there's a transition opportunity, they'll gladly take it.
Quick look by Temple, and the rebound to West Virginia, and a foul called on Temple. It's on Barnes. Lamont Barnes with the first foul of the game.
West Virginia comes into this game on a bit of a downer, losing their last three games to Miami, Rutgers, and feel like this is an opportunity for them to put all that aside. It's a new season, and they just want to come out and try to get a quick start in the game.
Well, they got off to a quick start during the season. They won 14 of their first 60. Jared West for 3, and he nails it.
West looked very comfortable on that jump shot. He's a terrific outside shooter, and if you don't skew your zone to put pressure on him when he has the basketball, he can do that thing, that type of shooting against you all night.
Sanchez finding Barnes right at the cup, and a foul called. The foul on Damian Owens.
Foul on Damian Owens. First person, team foul.
With the matchup zone defense, you're supposed to always have pressure on the basketball. You notice West had a little time to size the shot up and was able to knock it down, as I said earlier, very comfortably.
Barnes on the free throw line for the Owls, a 67% free throw shooter. And Temple is still scoreless. Barnes, one of the few players with Temple not from the immediate Philadelphia area. Lewin, the rebound for West Virginia. This is Owens.
Notice the pressure on the ball. Even when West is far out on the floor, they try to at least make sure there's a man on the basketball while everyone else in the matchup zone zones an area of the basket.
The shot clock at 13 for the Mountaineers. Solheim, Owens, Lewin in deep, and Solheim the offensive rebound.
Sometimes when you play that zone defense, it's a little tough to rebound because you don't have definite rebound assignments. You got to try to find someone out of your scrambling zone attack and block them out. Temple not doing a good job of that thus far.
18 to shoot. Temple gets the steal. Here is Sanchez. We've gone 3 minutes. The Owls have yet to score. Broken Burrow dumps into Barnes.
Not a lot of movement right now from Temple.
Here's Stewart, 12 to shoot. Dunkley swings the ball. Sanchez in deep and a foul called. The foul whistled against Adrian Pledger. First foul on him, two team fouls on West Virginia.
Again, when you look at Temple, there's not a lot of movement offensively, and Sanchez is going to have to try to get some penetration into the lane to create opportunities with the drop-off.
5-0 West Virginia. Almost, actually over 3 minutes have been played.
Right now, with the lack of movement, Temple's a very easy team to defend.
Sanchez missing, and it's rebounded by Lewin. Up ahead to Owens. Has it blocked, but he was fouled on the way in. The foul is on Lenard Stewart, the first foul on him. And two team fouls on Temple.
You know, one thing to note, when Temple is unable to score, well, they're going to have a hard time setting up their full court pressure. They want to come with that, but they usually come with it after a made basket or made field free throw.
Owens. Tip try good by Lewin. A quick start by West Virginia as they move up 7-0.
And West Virginia comes with a little full court pressure.
Sanchez handles to Broken Burrow.
Temple not doing a good job on the glass either end. Not many second opportunities on the offensive end, and they've given up several offensive rebounds to West Virginia.
And they're settling for the outside shot, it looks like, Greg. Now we have a timeout taken with 15:55 left in the half. So far, it's all West Virginia.
And I guess felt Christian had some hand in the recruiting department here.
Yes, indeed he did. CBS Sportsline is the best place to follow all of March mayhem. You'll get real-time scores, updated brackets, game previews and analysis, plus interviews and more. Go to keyword CBS Sportsline on America Online. Substitute for Washington, number 14, Chris Thompson, who's the backup point guard. Hasn't played many minutes late in the season. Nice passing. Walcott managed to score despite the effort by Darnell Williams to block it, and Washington takes the lead.
And that's attacking the press, too. They made him pay. Nice touch by Patrick. Goodness, what a feel early. Nice play.
Lumpkin to Bragg for the two that ties the game.
And Lumpkin with a lot to brag about on that little dish. Sweet.
Williams denied the inbounds pass and knocked it back out of bounds. 20-20 to score midway through the first half. Bob Bender is the coach at Washington. Came there after a successful run at Illinois State. He took Illinois State to one NCAA tournament during his 4 years there.
Bobby Aduki, a good friend of Mike Jaminski, who incidentally had a little baby. Nice pass again by Femerly.
And the ball lost along the end line by Luton. So Femerling's been impressive off the bench, but Washington has now turned it over 7 times.
Nice little combo job at the center spot, that 2 7-footers.
Michael Johnson in for Luton. Johnson's a freshman.
Replacing Newton.
See the Washington book where they have shoe sizes?
Yes.
20, 16, 14. I had 10s. That's why I'm with you.
Even at your height, you're a size 10.
Well, all my players, I meant.
Oh, I see. I thought you meant. So you have them.
Taking a big guy with the dribble. Got to get a better shot, though.
Braggs missed the shot. Thompson looks to push. He's one of just two seniors on the team for Washington. Jan Wooten is the other.
Gets a lot of advice from his dad. Good penetration.
Maybe advise him not to take such a tough shot. Leaning to the left, throwing up the runner.
Well, you didn't always listen to your dad, did
you? Most of the time I do.
Right off from Fennelly. That's heads up.
And now Watts having trouble with the dribble. Still tied at 20. Under 9 minutes left of the first half. First round action in the East from Washington, D.C. Sean McDonough and Bill Rafter.
Sean, this is where they have to run their stuff now. Be patient. Once you beat it, you don't have anything.
Kimberly tried to hit Johnson on a back cut. And a nice defensive play made by Posey.
Good patience here. Let Posey get back in the swing.
Lumpkin. Short for the three. Walcott thought about the quick shot.
Inhaling and exhaling early. I think of nerves right now.
Thompson calls out the play.
Back door, guard around. Well, this is where they do their magic, running their sets.
Bemerling spinning into the lane, and then he missed a short one.
And nice shot by Williams, still beats Bemerling down. Oh, run the big guy. Pretty and darn good luck. Right. That's why these guards are so tough. Lumpkin with a good feel.
He's fouled by the Huskies, number 22.
One way of negating size. Get the puppies going. You just see Patrick huffing and puffing. A little bit late, little kicks at the end. And this is the same way it looks up high.
Number four,
this is the look Femerly generally has.
And number 50, Todd McCullough returned for Washington. Number 12, Dan.
They say we have like head cam on McCullough or some tall man. We're just looking down from that vantage point. 8 points for Darnell Williams. Second team All-Atlantic 10 this season. There are a number of people in the Xavier camp who can't believe he was not a first team selection. And Dickow in the ballgame for Washington, number 12. He's a freshman guard. Vancouver, Washington. Whistle underneath. And Walcott holding the shot.
Xavier ball.
And a 3-second violation called against the Huskies. Their ninth turnover. Xavier by two.
Temple coming back with a chance to string a couple of hoops together. They're down by six.
Jones is a 35% shooter from the outside, but I don't think that was a shot that Gil Catlett wanted. It was early on the shot clock, and you didn't force Temple to have to work defensively.
Broken Burrow shoots again from deep. The rebound comes off to Damian Owens. Temple does a good job recovering in transition.
You know, Temple doesn't begin to get the basketball into that paint area, they're going to have a very tough time winning this basketball game.
Brokenborough off the drive, and Brokenborough with the basket. It's a four-point lead for West Virginia.
And that's their first transition basket. That's their first point in the paint. Let's see if this can get Temple going.
So we've played a little over 7 minutes here in the first half. Jared West steps inside. And West has his second basket, 5 points in the game. Court press by the Mountaineers. West to steal. Another quick hitting play by West Virginia. And a 20-second timeout taken by John Chaney.
I gotta imagine that John Chaney will let his team hear it. Right now they look very lethargic. They're slow of foot out there. And West Virginia is taking advantage of just about every mistake. Here's the trap. A very solid trap, and the turnover, an easy layup for West, who's having a very nice start to this basketball game.
Don't forget, at the conclusion of every NCAA tournament game, we'll select a Chevrolet Most Valuable Player of the Game from each team So far, Chevrolet has awarded over $6.5 million to the scholarship funds of America's colleges and universities. Jim Durham with Greg Kelser and Mike Mayock here in Boise. A quick start by the 10th-seeded West Virginia Mountaineers as they have opened up a 13-5 lead.
You know, when you talk about full-court pressure, quite naturally you say, hey, that's Temple's strength. But West Virginia, with their athleticism, they can full-court pressure as well. And they've sprung it on Temple, and I don't think Temple was quite ready for this. They turned the ball over two times. Make it three.
Maybe so if it goes out of bounds to West Virginia. That's the turnover. Stewart returning for Temple. And the Owls have Greer in the lineup now. Off the drive, Pledger missed the shot, rebounded by Temple. 8-point lead for West Virginia. Perhaps an upset in the making in our first game. Greer for three. Picked off by Lewin. 5 rebounds already for Brian Lewin. Gorey under pressure, underneath to Lewin. Great passing on the interior, but a 3-second call is going to cost him.
Yeah, just a little bit too unselfish that time, but it was superb passing. West Virginia looks very comfortable. Temple has to regroup.
John Chaney having to think about it with the Temple Owls as they're down 8 early.
A tradition.
Civic Center, the East Sub-Regional, North Carolina Navy, and the game summary.
Well, take a look at the fact that the turnovers are a killer. North Carolina only averages 13 a game. Look at the shot attempts. 30 attempts for Navy. They're quicker to the basketball a little bit, and Carolina looks a little frustrated. Just a little bit. They want this game a little more up-tempo, and Don DeVoe is happy. What you want to do as a big underdog, play this game in 5-minute segments, try to be close every 5 minutes and hang in there, and hopefully the higher seed team gets a little frustrated towards the end of the ballgame. We're nearing the first half. They're only down 6, and so far they're playing outstanding.
Here's Lookaville. Chris Williams pops out. 13 on the shot clock for the midshipman. Heary, pull-up, jump shot, got it.
And Heary playing to the crowd. He hits a jump shot. He continues to do the things he needs to do. And only down 4.
Akhtar Jai the other way, looks backside. With Elijah forced to take a 3. It's short. Jai with the rebound and a new shot clock for the Tar Heels.
And it's hard to make jump shots when it's a second thought. Oh, Elijah turned around, he didn't have anything and waited, then finally he made it. That's what Carolina has been trying to do. Just hard to get it inside to Jamison.
Jamison with 9, and when you need an easy bucket, you go to the franchise. 32-26, 2:26 remaining in the first half. Navy really patient on offense, working for a good shot. Lookaville from the parking lot. And the ball knocked out of bounds, and it's last up by the top. Actually by Navy.
Hey, look at Antoine Jamison. He continues to move without the ball always. He's tough to defend. He's big. He's strong. He's active. Finally, they got an offensive rebound. He got on the low block. Good bounce pass away from the defense. And easy, too.
He checks out of the game. On the floor for the Tar Heels, Cota and Williams in the backcourt. Vince Carter, Okalaja, and Jai in the frontcourt. 32-26, approaching the 2-minute mark of the first half. Williams high-low finds Jai, missed the jam, picked up by Cota in the corner. Here's Carter, power dribble, and a two-hand stuff. Oh, my. So Vince Carter makes it a 34-26 game. Heary leaning in, double clutch, and it rattled out. Cota the other way. Carolina sensing a run. Williams reverse layup, and it doesn't go.
Good bounce pass by Cota. Williams a little nonchalant on that finish.
Josh Williams give and go. Look at Bill. Ah, great play. Textbook style for the Naval Academy.
Never want to allow a team, Gus, to get confidence on their face in this Navy ball club. You look at them, and they feel like they can play on the offensive end. They're struggling on the defensive rebounding part of this ballgame.
1 minute to go, 36-28. Ed Cota with his fifth point of the first half. And maybe a whistle up top called against Vince Carter of North Carolina. Now coming up on Pennzoil at the half, Greg Gumbel, Clark Kellogg, and Dean Smith will get you updated on all tournament news, all the scores, highlights, plus a live look at all the action going on in the NCAA tournament. It's all coming up on Pennzoil at the half. Vince Carter picks up his third foul and sits down. 53.8 seconds to go. He has 8 points. And at the line for Navy is Mike Heary, a terrific free throw shooter. As I said, and he missed the first one, over 84% on the season.
Happens every time, Gus.
Cota wrapped it around. Jai lays it up and in.
That's what Ed Cota does. Best of all, penetrates, gives up the pass. Fifth in the country in assists. And it's 7.5 a ball game.
And the largest lead of the game for North Carolina, 38-28. 36.8 remaining in the first half of play. And here in Hartford, we have a really competitive bracket. North Carolina Navy followed by UNC Charlotte out of Conference USA and Illinois Chicago from the MCC, Princeton UNLV, Michigan State against Eastern Michigan, and if you haven't seen Earl the Squirrel Boykins, 5'5", diminutive point guard out of Eastern Michigan, you would want to hang around when the Eagles come up tonight.
Well, we have some great games here, Gus. The team Cleves will have something to say about Mr. Boykins having a good game tonight. And Princeton UNLV, what a matchup. UNLV comes in as hot as any ball club in the country, winning 4 games in the WAC to get here, upsetting Utah, Fresno, and New Mexico.
About a 7-second differential between the game clock and the shot clock.
And see if North Carolina attack the ball when it gets to an area they can. A lot of times they want to dictate what the other team does.
Hate to shoot. Chris Williams lost his footing. Lookaville jacked up, got to the hole, leaned inside, can't take it in. Frederick with the board. Ahead to Cota. Carolina's Cota lost it on his hip, picked it up. And that is the end of the first half of play. 38-28, our score after one half. Now let's go to New York where Greg Gumbel is standing by.
All right, Gus, so it's a 10-point lead for North Carolina in Hartford. We want to take you now to Washington, D.C. for the other first-round game in the East that's taking place, the Washington Huskies and Xavier's Musketeers. Washington in the lead by 2. Let's join Sean McDonough and Bill Raftery.
A minute 40 remaining in the first half here in Washington, D.C. Washington in purple, the 11 seed, has a 2-point lead over Xavier, the number 6 seed. It's been a very tight game. And the ball thrown away by Braggs of the Musketeers. Now Donald Watts for Washington.
They're giving a little scratching of their own on the defensive end. It's turning into good opportunity baskets for the Huskies.
5 points for Donald Watts. Xavier favors an up-tempo approach, but they really haven't been able to get going up and down.
Well, you got to make shots. I mean, get your defense set. They're just unable. This is a situation, dead ball, they can get after it.
For Xavier, number 33. Muskets 3 went out of bounds, and Washington will play it in again. A 20-second timeout has been called to give us time to check the brackets. Here in the East in Washington, D.C., later this afternoon, South Carolina against Richmond, the Spiders back in the tournament. With their history of upsets in the NCAA, then Indiana and Oklahoma tonight, followed by Connecticut and Fairleigh Dickinson University.
Now Skip's team right now, and not that he's distraught, but they're not getting that energy from the press. They not making shots part of that difficulty. Also, I think rushing shots and not getting the sequence set up where they do get a touchdown on the box. I think they're a great inside team. I think Posey running in there could do some damage.
Well, you made the point, tough to press when you don't make a shot. And as we saw a moment ago, they've gone 5.5 minutes without a field goal. Down to 1 minute left in the half. Dickow to Watts. Green, Femerling, and Luton on the floor for Washington. Dickow short with a 3. He's made a couple off the bench. Halo Green.
There's that hook.
Halo Green.
Bob Hilbert's had a great hook shot before your time, I might add. And mine. Will be Washington Green. Sitting back home enjoying that one. They just honored him during that UCLA game, incidentally.
We're glad to hear that at age 80, former Washington coach Marv Heisman still around the program, makes it to the home games and follows the Huskies very closely.
One thing to say against UCLA, he's the last guy to beat John Quinn.
He was in 1975. Look at the head of the pack, just a great hustle by Watts, taking nothing for granted.
Good hustle.
Well,
he plays well. He's a different team. Good perimeter game to complement the inside people. No goal.
That's the end of his first desperation for the Bucks and Swift. Xavier, 30.
From Sun Donald of the Huskies here in the first half. At the end of the first half, the score is Washington 38 and Xavier 30. Greg Gumbel, Clark Kellogg, and Dean Smith will be along with Pennzoil at the half. Right after this message and the word from your local station.
We have two games at halftime in the East, in Hartford and in Washington, D.C., and we'll be taking you live out to Boise, Idaho for first-round action in the West.
CBS Sports presents Pennzoil at the Half, sponsored by Pennzoil, specially formulated for today's stop-and-go driving. Stop, go, Pennzoil.
Welcome back to our studios in New York as we continue down the road to the Final Four. Greg Gumbel along with Clark Kellogg and Dean Smith. Let's run down the scores and highlights for you, beginning with one of those games that are at halftime. Navy and North Carolina in East action play in Hartford, Connecticut, and the Tar Heels with a 10-point lead. Bill Guthridge, boy, making his debut as a head coach in the tournament. Antoine Jamison, Clark.
Doing his work inside, but not only did he do work, he got dinged in the nose, but was able to recover and come back a little later.
And then Navy keeping it close early on. Hassan Booker will keep the midshipman in it with the jump shot from the side, but North Carolina's 10-point lead at this point is their biggest of the day. What'd you think about North Carolina, Coach?
Well, I think Navy did a great job defensively. We were trying to make the tough pass inside and threw it away 12 times, but you give credit to Navy as well.
In North Carolina, they're going to be so happy that you still refer to them
as
we. That's all right. It's entirely understandable.
Right.
Meanwhile, in Washington, D.C., another game at halftime. The Huskies with an 8-point lead on Xavier at halftime. Cheerleaders, Clark. Xavier Jr., Darnell Williams takes the feed inside, goes up strong for the jam. There's Bob Bender. He saw his team come back.
They really did come back strong. Donald Watt strong to the rack. Hoop and Harm in Washington doing a nice job turning turnovers into points here. They finished with a strong run at the end of the half to lead by 8.
Deion Luton and the Steel and the Jam. You know, the Xavier team, you have high hopes for them, but so far it's been the Huskies into that first half in a strong way.
They really did. They're playing with a lot of poise, doing a nice job, again, converting turnovers to baskets, and when they do break the pressure of Xavier, getting high-quality shots.
All right. Meanwhile, in Boise, Idaho, first-round action in the West between West Virginia and Temple. It is a 30-14 lead for the Mountaineers. Jim Durham and Greg Kelser are standing by with the action at the BSU Pavilion.
Kelser here in Boise, a mild upset in the making in game one. The 10th-seeded West Virginia Mountaineers with the ball and a 16-point lead. As Owens fires, and Temple now trying to cut into that big lead. They would like to get it down, I'm sure, inside of double digits before the half.
That last shot taken by Owens, he's not a great outside shooter, but he's a slasher, a guy that likes to get the ball to the basket. He can hit the outside shot, but that's not his strength. But right now, I think that West Virginia, they're getting very good shots. They got the ball reversal going.